Dear friends, we have come this morning to worship God and to celebrate the hope that we have in Jesus Christ. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die." Romans 14 proclaims, we do not live to ourselves. We do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, so that he might be the Lord of both the dead and the living. My friends, we have come this morning to give thanks for the life of our friend, our mother, our sister, our grandmother, Francis Lance Butler, through whom God has blessed us. Let us come and worship God. Let us pray. Eternal God, we acknowledge the uncertainty of our life on earth. We each are given a mere handful of days. Yet our span of life seems nothing in your sight. Eternal God, even as we celebrate a life of 89 years, it still seems too short. You promise that even in the valley of the shadow of death, you are with us. So now, O God, turn your ear to our cry and hear our prayer. O God, who gave us birth, you promise to hear us when we pray. You know our needs before we ask. And now by your Son, Jesus Christ, we know that we have a true and real hope, that death is not the end, but only a new beginning of our life with you. Show us now your grace, that as we face the mystery of death, we may see the light of eternity. Amen. We will sing from the red hymn book. Those of you in the front row, it's underneath you, the rest is in the front of you. 98, Morning Has Broken. Throughout the ages, God's people when looking for comfort, have found the full expression of human emotion in the scriptures. When you feel happy, you can rejoice with the people in the Bible. When you feel sad, you can grieve, you can mourn with the people in the Bible. Even when you are angry, you can yell at the world, you can yell at God with the people in the Bible. And in turning to Scripture, we can find understanding, we can find comfort, sympathy, and the way to true peace. Our first reading comes from Psalm 139. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely. You hem me in behind and before and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high I cannot attain it. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and settle at the farthest limits of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me and the night wraps itself around me, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is as bright as the day, for darkness is as light to you. For it was you who formed my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works that I know very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes beheld my unformed substance. In your book were written all the days that were formed for me when none of them yet existed. How weighty to me are your thoughts, O God! How vast is the sum of them! I try to count them. They are more than the sand. And I come to the end. I am still with you. Search me and know my heart, O God. Test me and know my thoughts. See if there is any wicked way in me and lead me in the way everlasting. And as it is for many believers, the 23rd Psalm is a great source of comfort for believers, for those in these beautiful words are reminded the great love God has for each of us, the sheep of his pasture. And so I invite you to read together with me in unison. You'll find the words in the bulletin. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And now, in turning to scriptures from the New Testament, these words from our Lord and Savior, may we find comfort and peace in knowing that our security is certain, promised here. For Jesus says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. For in my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again, and I will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place that I'm going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" And Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. I've said these things to you while I'm still with you, but the Holy Spirit, the Advocate, who the Father will send in my name, will remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace. Peace, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid." The last words of our scriptures give us this hope. "I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore. For the former things have passed away.'" My friends, these are the words of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Today, on behalf of the family, Steve will come and share some of his remembrances.
Good morning. First, I want to thank all of y'all for coming and making the time on a Saturday to be here for Mother and for us. As you know, this was real easy until right now. Today's going to be the last time that you, as a group of friends, family members, and relatives, and I will meet together to remember my mother, Frances Lance Butler. I don't consider myself a public speaker, but I always feel at times like this that it's important to take a few minutes to talk publicly about who this person is and what she has meant to me. You might think that as one of Mother's children, that speaking about her would be a pretty easy thing to do. That the problem would be having too much to say and trying to keep your comments to a reasonable amount of time, but that isn't the case. We like to think that we know our husbands, our wives, brothers, sisters, children, our closest friends better than anyone. The truth is, when it comes down to it, there's much more that we don't know compared to what we do. The only things we really know about a person are those things we're able to observe and what that person's willing to share with us. Most often, the reason we don't know is because we never took the time to ask. Years ago, when I was a boy, I was probably in middle school, I asked Mother what her middle name was before she got married. That single question resulted in a 12 to 13 page autobiography of Mother's childhood and her early adult life that I didn't find until many years later. Her middle name was Loreen, by the way. At the beginning of her account, she wrote that she hadn't realized that I didn't know this and said, "There are many things that I'm sure you'll wonder about, which is why I've decided to write some things down." That account has given me an insight into Mother's life that I otherwise would have never known. I only knew her from the context of mother or being a parent in that relationship to a son. Outside of that, I only knew very general information about her life before me or apart from me. And sadly, as a typical teenager or young adult, I never really considered it. Only at times like this do we consider the lost opportunity we had to have a deep connection to those we say we care about the most. I'm glad Mother took the time to write these things down, and I regret that it didn't result in a larger conversation. As most of you know, Mother was born and grew up in Union County from about 1935 until the early 1950s. We always said Mother was from Blairsville, but she actually lived in a little place in the road called Lunar, 15 miles from Blairsville. In today's world, 15 miles is not considered a significant distance, but in Union County in the 1940s, given the transportation of the day, that was a trip that could take 2 hours or more. According to my mother, life was not easy. Mother was the oldest of five children, four girls, Mother, my Aunt Carnell, who's here today, Juan Seal and Mildred, and one boy, my Uncle Richmond. As young girls, the dresses they wore were made from feed sacks. Mother said the area that they lived in was very remote with no electricity or running water, although her daddy was able to get a generator that provided electricity for their home and for their grandmother's home long before electricity came to the area. Mother remembered that on Saturday nights they looked forward to sitting around the radio with friends, listening to the Grand Ole Opry. They did not get indoor plumbing until after Mother moved to Atlanta. Mother said the road that passed by their house was not paved until after 1956 and was almost impassable during the winter months. She said the school bus that would have to take her to Union County High School could not get to her house due to the bad roads. In addition, she was probably the only student that lived in the area, so Mother had to walk 3 to 4 miles to catch a bus to go to Fanning County High School for 3 years until the Union County bus could get to her house. She attended Union County High School during her senior year and graduated in 1951. Around age 17, soon after graduation, Mother was encouraged by a relative to move to Atlanta to help her with her children and to go to school. She received her diploma from Marsh Business College in November of 1952, and soon after was employed with the Southern Regional Board of Education in Atlanta. Mother described this period of her life as, quote, "a happy time for me. I enjoyed my work and especially enjoyed living in the apartment with her other girlfriends that she met when she moved to Atlanta." Mother met Daddy in 1955 or 56 when she went to the Emory Dental School to have some dental work done. They married in November of 1956 and moved to Clarksville in 1957. John was born in August of 1957. Cindy was born in August of 1958. I was born in March of 1961, but don't tell anybody. And Mike was born in April of 1964. In 1965 or 66, we moved to the house on West Glade Creek Road where Mother lived until she passed. All of the Lance women were great cooks, and Mother was one of the best. I remember hearing the story of how Mother killed Judge Sutton. Mother had made a pumpkin chiffon pie for a church potluck dinner, and they said he liked it so much he ate half of it or more. That night after he went to bed, he died of a heart attack. John remembers that there were people who would find out which cake Mother had brought to the school fall festivals for the cake walk, and they would donate money ahead of time to get the cake that Mother made. Even so, there were times she would make something, as Cindy remembers, and then I did too, bran muffins for dinner that would not meet her children's approval. For those times, there was a big brass bowl that sat on our dinner table with artificial fruit in it. In the center of this arrangement was an artificial hollow pineapple with a leaf crown that could be removed. And so that was where the food that we didn't like went. I don't know how Mother did it, but she was involved in every activity the four of us ever participated in. School parties, kindergarten and other school field trips, fall festivals at school, athletic booster clubs, selling concessions. She and Daddy never missed a game in all the years we played any sport that I'm aware of. When I couldn't make out any voices from the crowd, I always knew when Mother was cheering. After we moved to the house on West Glade Creek, there were already four of us there, but it seemed like on any given weekend that there were people that would come to spend the night. And so there was always a house full of kids. I never heard Mother or Daddy complain. Mother always fed everybody. And then they built the swimming pool. As far as I remember, we were one of the few families that had a swimming pool. And like in the movie Field of Dreams, if you build it, they will come. And so there were always people at the house, and there was always some kind of a party at the house. Mother and Daddy's bedroom was right over the swimming pool. And we would be out there till 1 o'clock in the morning or later. And they never said anything. I never remember them ever saying anything. Mother was terrified of thunderstorms and lightning. I remember one time she came to pick Mike and I up from school, and there was a big thunderstorm cloud heading our way. We started driving home, and then Mother passed the turn to go home. And she just kept driving. I finally asked her where we were going, but she didn't have an answer, even though I kept asking. And she kept driving, and she drove to Tocoa trying to outrun the thunderstorm. At home during a thunderstorm, Mother would hide in the bathroom and cover her head. She was also afraid of heights. One year on a family vacation to Canada, we were crossing the Mackinac Suspension Bridge in Michigan that is 200 feet high and 7,000 feet long. And Mother stayed in the floorboard of the car all the way across. On a less positive note, Mother could be stubborn and very opinionated. She never had a problem telling her children, and even people who weren't her children, what you were doing wrong and what you needed to do to correct whatever that was. And once she had told you, she would tell you again and again and again. Looking back on it now, there might have been some of those times that I probably should have listened. Mother loved playing bridge with a close group of women who were friends for years. That included Melba Caudill, Jean Miller, Jeanette Crowder, Edna Elrod, Charlotte Reeves, Catherine Lunsford, Sonia Bowen, Eureka Jackson, Marnie Boatwright, Sally Hawks, Mary Moore, Barbara Kimsey, and others. She and Daddy loved the girls in Daddy's office like family. Annelle Ivester, Tammy Wood Barrett, Janelle Stewart, Tracy Vandiver Smith, Shelley Hammond Gosnell, and they always celebrated Daddy's birthday and Christmases together. Mother had to survive being the first person to find Daddy after his accident. She survived breast cancer and chemotherapy. She survived watching her daddy, mother, two younger sisters, Wansel and Mildred, and a younger brother, Richmond, pass. She had a hard life growing up and a hard life at times trying to get others to grow up. During most of my life, I never felt especially close to Mother. We all had our own unique relationships with her, but I always knew she loved me and loved all of us. When Mother's health started declining about 4 years ago, Mike and his family moved in to take care of Mother. After a couple of years, John's daughter Anna began staying with her during the week, and John, Cindy, and I rotated weekends. I've always been in awe of Mike's ability to step in and do the difficult job of a caregiver, and always said I wouldn't be able to do that. I felt like that required a level of intimacy and closeness to someone that my relationship with Mother didn't have. For the first few weeks, I had to call Anna, and she would come and help with those things. But eventually, you have to get past that. And we did. Today, I'll tell you that the time I spent with Mother during those last 2 years was the best, closest time we ever had. I know that she loved me, and she knew that I loved her. It's terrible that circumstances had to be what they were for us to have that time together, but it wouldn't have happened any other way. Mother, I love you. I'm sorry for all the things I should have done and should have been, but wasn't. I hope you're in a good place and that you'll look in on me from time to time. And Mother, try not to tell him how to run the place. Thank you.
That's a beautiful tribute, Steve. Yes. Our last reading this morning from a familiar text, Paul's second letter to Timothy, chapter 4. As Paul nears the end of his own life, in reflection he says, "As for me, I am already being poured out as a libation, an offering. And the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. And from now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which is the Lord, the righteous judge will give me on that day. And not also to me, not only to me, but also to those who have longed for his appearing. By the time I had arrived at the church, several years now, Francis was already homebound. And I'm sorry I didn't get the chance to get acquainted with her, but I have heard what a wonderful person she was. Her dedication to others, her family, to this church, her hospitality, her generosity. As Steve has already said, she was very comfortable in the kitchen, making sure everything was always taken care of. Like today, if there was to be a reception, a church meal to be planned, she would be right there in the middle, helping. And in her last days, I paid a visit to the home, spent some time with her and also with Steve. As we sat beside her bed, we offered prayers and read scriptures, anointed her head with oil, fragrant oil. And although she was weak, it seemed to us in that time, in the sharing of scriptures and prayer, she found some sense of awareness, some comfort, maybe even clarity and some peace. And Steve was kind enough to share with me some of his mother's autobiography. I found it a fascinating look back into time, the 30s and 40s and 50s. And as Steve said, it was a difficult life back then, but her writings do not focus on the trials, on the difficulties or the struggles. They're filled with joy, memories of time spent with cousins and neighbors, of the love of her own grandparents, especially of her grandmother, who also loved to bake and to cook. Appropriate to today, she wrote early on that one of her earliest memories were of her great-grandmother dying. She said the smell of camphor filled the house. Family and strangers filled the home to attend to the needs of the family, and she was scared and shy. The experience was significant. She also reminisced about the death of her grandfather, how again the house was filled with relatives and friends, and how she ran and hid in the yard until they all left. For a child, death seemed mysterious, ominous, maybe even scary. And how poignant these stories now are some 80 years later as we gather at her service, remembering her faith, her life, her courage even in life. 88 years of living, of loving, of surviving. As I read, as the Apostle Paul was nearing the end of his own life, writing his memoir, his instructions to his young apprentice Timothy, he looks back with confidence and says, I have fought the good fight. I have run the race. I have won. I believe certainly the same can be said of your mother. Paul writes these words for Timothy's sake to inspire him by the grace of God to duplicate them, to replicate them in his own life, to be filled in his life with courage and with faith. He says, I've done everything necessary in my time, and now you must do what is necessary with yours. These are words of endurance, of encouragement that we so desperately need to hear today. For we live in a time of fear, of anxiety, of worry. in his words to Timothy, Paul, however, has no sense of giving up, no giving in. He seems to possess the confident assurance that God will lead him to his purposeful end. And I believe there's no doubt, no worry that Frances has won her prize. She was certainly a model before us of generosity, of hospitality, of love and endurance. But let me say, it's not her self-righteousness that earns her the prize. That prize was won on her behalf by her Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It's Christ's righteousness, Christ's crown. She clung to that righteousness with all that she had. Friends, we are people of grace. And grace is the source of our hope, as it was for Frances. We are God's beloved, who in Christ have been graciously and mercifully given life abundant and life eternal. The power of God's grace is that it is completely in the hands of God. And we can trust that Frances is in those loving hands now and today. Perhaps death should not be feared, not mysterious and ominous as it might seem, not for people of faith, for God's grace is bigger than our fear. God's love is greater than death, for death is not the end, but a beginning, a new beginning. Frances has finished strong, gained the prize, won the race, and is now living in the loving, grace-filled arms of her beloved Lord. There are many more stories that we could tell, and I encourage you to do them, to tell them to one another. As we conclude the service, you're invited to come down to Fellowship Hall for some refreshments and a time of remembering, a time of celebrating. I encourage you to tell stories to one another. And let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for your servant Frances, and for the opportunity we each had to be blessed by her. For you have given us a new and living hope in Jesus Christ. And we thank you that by dying, Christ destroyed the power of death. And by rising from the grave, he opened the way for each of us to eternal life. So help us to know that because Christ lives, we shall live also. We offer these, our prayers, confident of your love for us, your love for Frances. Amen. What shall we say about all this? For if God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him generously give us all things? For in all things we are more than conquerors, and I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Let us stand and sing our closing hymn again in the Red Book 143.
Behold the cross of Jesus.
Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that you may abound in hope and with the power of the Holy Spirit. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you, be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and bring you peace. Amen.
Thank you.